morning, everyone. Welcome to the meeting of the Special Committee on Government Records Retention on Friday, November 6th. The chair is absent today, so I need someone to nominate another member to serve as chair, and then the committee will vote. Can I have a nomination, please?
Hannah?
Okay, any other nominations? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Carried. Ms. Bell, please take the chair.
And the meeting's already, do we need to recall the order to
nope.
order? Okay. Thank you very much. So this is the Special Committee on Government Records Retention. It's Friday, November 6th. And a reminder that the context for this committee, I think in the past you've sort of reviewed the motion that has the brings the committee to meet. Whereas in June 9, 2020, order of the Office of the Information and Privacy Commissioner raised serious questions about the possibility of government records being improperly deleted, whereas access to government records is fundamental to open and transparent government, whereas government has committed to an external review of this issue, whereas an external review will not provide the openness and transparency that the public expects and deserves, therefore be it resolved that a special committee of the Legislative Assembly on Government Records Retention be created with a six-person membership consisting of two members from government members, two members from the official opposition, and two members from the third party. Therefore be it further resolved that the committee study the missing records referred in the Information and Privacy Commissioner's order and the current practices related to electronic records and security, and therefore be it further resolved to the committee report back to the Legislative Assembly with recommendations within 6 months. May I have a motion for adoption of the agenda as presented? Gord?
Yeah.
And seconded by Corey, thank you. So I would like to welcome our guest today, Melissa James. I'd also like to make a quick note that I would like on behalf of the committee to extend our condolences to the family of Michelle Beaton and on the passing of her father, Glenn. It is always difficult for our legislators when we have our fellow colleague, and it's difficult for us not to be able to be there with them today. So our thoughts are with the family on the passing of a beloved father. Melissa, did you have a presentation?
Yes, I have a short one.
Super. Would you like to start with that?
Sure.
And then if we have, go through your presentation, and we'll hold questions until the end.
Sure.
And then if there's any questions from the floor.
I appreciate that.
That's great. Thank you.
It's not a very long presentation, but I thought it might be useful to get a little bit of context around, introduce myself a bit to you and take you back in time almost 8 years ago to kind of the time frame that you're looking at. Can you hear me okay? All right. If I start to fade, just tell me.
Just to point, Melissa, that the microphone isn't an amplifying microphone.
Yes, that's
thank they like,
you,
yeah.
Ryan. Yeah, Ryan's been very good, so thank you for all your logistics. He's done a good job of getting me organized, because I would have assumed it would. So. Just in terms of myself, I'm Melissa James, obviously. I'm a professor at the university. I have a BBA from UPEI, homegrown, an MBA, and a PhD. My background in industry and in academia, and my research focuses in on marketing in a variety of different contexts. So that's kind of my background. And I was appointed Deputy Minister of Innovation and Advanced Learning in 2011, and I left in 2013. At that point in time, the role was to oversee economic development opportunities for the province, particularly looking at business diversification, immigration, labor market, post-secondary and skills development. And I think it's useful because, as we all know, governments change departments all the time. And what exists today may not actually exist the way it did in 2013. So back then, the department was Innovation and Advanced Learning, and it had three major entities, if you will. The Department of Workforce and Advanced Learning, which has skills PEI and post-secondary. Finance PEI, which was created in 2012, I think, or 2011. And the CEO of Finance PEI and the CEO of Innovation PEI, those two crown agencies reported into the Department of Innovation and Advanced Learning. So that kind of gives you the structure at that point in time. And I want to thank Ryan, and I know I asked some questions back to the committee, so I wanted to get clarity around what I could help you with. So I understand, as Ms. Bell just pointed out, that you're here to study the records of the Privacy Commissioner, that the Privacy Commissioner studied. I did not participate in that process, and nor was I asked to, just for context. I wasn't aware of the process. And then you're also studying current practices related to electronic records. I can only speak to what happened 2013, before that, in that period of time, because I really don't know the current record practices of government, and I'm not involved with government, so that all ended with my appointment in 2013. But thanks to Ryan and the chair, the committee clarified really what you want to focus on with me was around the findings of the Auditor General's report in regard to records retention. I met with the Auditor General. I fully participated in that process with her and her team. When I left government in 2013, all of my records and emails stayed with government for its normal use in business practice. And I had no involvement with any records after I left government. So that terminated when I left. So again, all my files and emails were left there in 2013. And the Auditor General stated in the report that when an employee left government, the normal practice at that time was to remove their email account. I wasn't privy to anything around removing of the email account. I was gone. So anything, I think, related to that particular issue or concern, I think IT would probably be the best people to speak to about that. But however, I have seen my emails, I've seen my records, and I use those to successfully defend myself in the ongoing litigation. So they do exist. So really, I just want to thank you for the invitation. I know there's always kind of interest in what happens in regards to records, and I think the work of the committee is absolutely valuable. And I hope that this kind of gives you some information around my records that is helpful to you, at least sets some context for you. Unfortunately, we're going back almost 8 years in terms of what my personal knowledge is. And I think IT has more knowledge than I absolutely ever would in that front. But as I said, I've seen my emails, I've seen my records, and I've used those to successfully defend myself. So those are there. So yes, that's really my very brief presentation.
Thank you, Melissa. I have questions from the floor. Corey?
Thank you, Chair. And sorry, it's hard to see you, Melissa.
There we go. I'll lean back.
And just let me know if you have a hard time hearing me. Did you have any knowledge before you left government that your emails would be deleted after you left?
No.
Did you at any time, I guess either before you left government or after your request, like, I guess when you leave government, like, these are important files and emails and records, and as the holder of those records, you're responsible for them. Was it your hope that they wouldn't be deleted, or that these records would be kept too?
Absolutely
not. I can't recall even thinking about my records, Mr. Deagle, at all. It was just, your records are left. I left government. I assumed they would be used in the normal course of business. They were left intact. So no, I don't.
Corey?
Have you ever used a personal email to conduct government business?
It's possible. I don't know. I couldn't going back a long time, it would be possible, particularly, I can't remember when, but there would be times, especially working at home, you would, our IT system wasn't super reliable all the time. We had lots of glitches with it, so it may have.
Corey?
Because there is emails where you use your Gmail account to conduct.
Yeah, there might be, yes.
Might be. And I think it's public record. I guess why would you have used your Gmail account to conduct?
That would be the reason why, I think. I wouldn't recall any email in specifically that I would have sent, but I recall sitting at my desk at home not being able to log into GroupWise fairly regularly, and I worked at night almost every day. So it would really depend on the system on that day if I had to get something done.
Tori?
So you're saying that you had to use your private email because the government, you couldn't log into your government email to conduct.
Yes, that would be the reason why.
The most important files of government at that time.
Which files were the most important in government?
I wasn't involved
in e-gaming.
Corey?
But you were involved in the loyalty card program?
Yes.
And Philip Walsh, correct?
Yes, that's correct.
Yes. Okay. Which it's all connected.
For some people, yes, I can see that.
Yes.
But not from my perspective, in terms that it was an initiative, a separate initiative.
Yeah. Okay.
Corey?
So I guess as your position as Deputy Minister of Tourism, Culture, because you were, in your presentation, you stated you were Deputy of, was it Innovation up until 2011 to 2013, but 2007 to 2011, you were Tourism and Culture.
Yes, I guess I didn't touch on
that, but yes.
Yeah. So I guess, could you kind of explain to the committee what your involvement was in kind of the e-gaming file, the loyalty card program, kind of how it all?
E-gaming would be zero. I wasn't involved in e-gaming at all. The loyalty program actually was an initiative that was discussed in the department probably for quite some time. I guess I got to bring you back to the strategy a bit. So tourism, we had invested quite substantially in a CRM system, which is called a customer relationship management system. And what CRMs, in their full capacity, is really the big data, right? It's analytics. It's an analytics program. So for us to even have a CRM program as a tourism destination is pretty cool, because it's really hard for destinations to kind of have that kind of robust data that we have, and size was our advantage. But we always knew to evolve it to the next level and to really use big data that you would have to have the operators participate in that. So that would be one way you would do that, like an Air Miles program, or what casinos do is get the cards into the hands, or get, you know, something in the hands of your consumers so that you can track behavior and consumer spending. And for a destination to do that would be a game changer in terms of competition. So that was kind of the germinating inside of the department at the time. So we were looking at, is that possible? And that's really what the loyalty program was a feasibility study to go, is it possible for the CRM to connect to the point of purchase terminals of operators? That's what we were looking at as a department. It wasn't about a card for us, it was about collecting that data.
Corey?
So as a senior government employee at the time, I guess what knowledge around records management and your duties as, I guess, both an employee and as an executive, I guess, can you describe your exit process? So when you left government, was it just kind of, okay, that's, you know, I'm not touching it, it's what they do with it, they do with it, or?
Yes, I don't recall any discussion about my records at all. It was administrative wrap up on your own personnel file, but you know, I think it, you know, as a senior executive in government, you're not filing your own records. You're things when your emails, they're in there. It's an assumption that it's being taken care of. In the normal course of business, staff would file records, right? Not unlike any other deputy minister.
Corey?
Did you take any steps to preserve your records?
I don't recall needing to do anything in particular to my records at all.
Corey?
When would you have been aware that your records were incomplete? Become aware of that?
In the news at some point, down years later. I don't know exactly when, but years later.
Corey?
Was that before legal action was taken? That
I don't know, to be honest. Whenever it appeared in the media, you could look it up. I don't know. I just remember becoming aware of it, not just from the media.
Once you became aware that your records were no longer there, were you concerned? Did you take any steps to try and help piece that together of what records would have been missing? That
those records didn't belong to me. Right, that was something that belonged to the department and to government and IT. I'm a private citizen at this stage. There's not much I can do.
Do you have any further questions?
Sorry,
okay. We have a couple other people on the list, so perhaps
you can go to someone else and come back.
We can do that and come back to you?
Yeah, that's fine.
That'd be great. Thank you. Trish Altas?
Thank you, Chair, and thank you for being here today and for your presentation. You mentioned that as Deputy Minister, there was an assumption that records retention was being taken care of or that was happening already. Is that because, just so I can understand, there was a stated policy that staff would follow in terms of how records needed to be maintained, particularly the records of the Deputy Minister?
I don't know. I can't recall particular policies. I just can't. I'm not saying they weren't there at the time. I just don't, nothing comes to mind as I reflect back. We're going back a decade. So I don't remember policy or what the staff would be particularly following. So it would be whatever courts, again, as a deputy minister, if files come in, your assistant, your team, your staff are filing those and using those in the normal course of business. So there's an assumption, I guess, that things are being managed. Mm-hmm. But I don't recall a specific policy. I couldn't tell you one off the top of my head.
Trish?
Okay. I appreciate your honesty that you can't remember. I certainly hope that at this point there is a policy, clear policy in place, and I'm not one that I'm aware of, but I don't know if this committee has already gathered that information from the current government or not, or if that's within the scope of this, but at some point I would hope we would get some clarity on whether there is currently a policy, because when I hear government is functioning in any way around assumptions, that makes me quite nervous. I don't think that's appropriate. So one more follow-up question. Can you explain a little bit or elaborate on what the culture of records retention then in your department at that time was? So in terms of emails, but also keeping minutes of meetings and, what was the culture? Can you elaborate a bit?
Minutes were definitely taken in, I would call them more formal meetings. That would be very common practice. Informal meetings, not minutes, but certainly would be, if you were being briefed on a matter, it would be documented in some way that, there was a discussion or there'd be a briefing note or something of that. There would be some document created out of that. So for the most part, I don't think what government was doing at that time was any different than what the government in PEI have been doing for a number of years, so I guess it was just carrying on the common practice of, some meetings were more formal with minutes and some weren't.
Okay, just one more.
Trish Altas?
Thank you. And so how would you distinguish them between a meeting that was more formal or formal and an informal? Where was the line between you didn't need to keep minutes?
In general terms, I would say if there was a chair, there would be meetings, like minutes from those meetings. If there were, again, more informal meetings in your office with a few staff, there probably wouldn't be a chair, but there would be certainly a purpose of the meeting, so that there would be records from that meeting that in that regard.
Okay, that's all for now, Chair. Thank you.
Thanks. Ola?
Thank you, Chair. You mentioned earlier that you did have access later have access to your files to defend yourself in court. I'm just wondering if you can tell us what files were left and
what files were left with
government?
Well, I believe you mentioned that you used your email files to defend yourself in court.
I wouldn't recall.
So, as being in court, you did say you used the files to successfully defend yourself, and you must have been aware that there was missing files. So, I was just wondering why you didn't look for some of the missing files. We heard earlier testimony that. I think for Mr. Mix that when he did identify a file, he could look to other persons and actually did recover the file eventually. Could you clarify that?
I don't. When I look at the records that were used to successfully defend myself and 13 other people, They were fairly robust. There weren't gaps in decision making or anything of that nature. So there would be nothing that would stand out as missing.
Ola?
So clarify, you didn't actually personally miss any files, that you only read about missing files elsewhere.
That's right.
Thank you.
Corey Deagle.
Melissa, when you left government, all of your files, records were intact.
Yes.
And it would have been Neil Stewart who signed the deletion form for your email account.
That's what I read. But again, I don't have any personal knowledge of that.
Did you keep any paper copies of emails or files that would be...
Did I
take home paper copies?
No. Sorry, did you keep records... of emails.
In government to be filed?
Did you have hard copies of records?
Yes, things would be printed depending on the nature of a project or initiative or program. Things would be printed. I think you have to understand kind of the ministers and the deputy minister's office at that time. I don't know what it's like now, but at that point in time, if the minister and the deputy minister would oversee projects, right, or oversee initiatives and provide that. But the day construction.
That was pretty substantive. Yeah.
Should I wait or?
No. Yeah. He's just going to ask them to ensure
that they don't continue.
Continue. That's correct.
Where was I? The day to day. I'm going to give you an example. So if there was a loan being given to a business for some reason, you would get a briefing and an understanding, and there would be, a record of a meeting with the minister or deputy minister and a briefing note. But all of those files are with the staff who are working on that particular file. So the day-to-day isn't in the deputy or the minister's office, if that makes sense. So you're going to see the volume of records. This room wouldn't hold the number of printed copies that you would need. So there's an understanding that those files are with the people that are working on that file. And then whatever pieces that you get are pieces that are held for a deputy or a minister. On the other hand, if I was a deputy minister chairing an FPT meeting, then those records would be held in the minister's and deputy's office, because that is where that project relies or its home is there, so to speak. Does that make sense?
Corey?
Yes, of somewhat. So would there be any of those hard copies there now? Would you have had any hard copies, I guess, related to like the loyalty card program?
I've seen hard copies. They don't belong to me anymore. Obviously, they belong to government. But I have seen the hard copies, yes.
Corey?
So government would have those hard copies. Okay.
Corey?
Oh, sorry, Chair.
That's okay.
I keep forgetting to go through. I'm wondering if you can give some more context. And so you use your personal email account to do government business. And I guess what government business did you conduct on your personal email account? So I know, like, you did email Philip Walsh around Simplex and financial services platform. I'm wondering if you can give us some context on what.
You'd be asking me to remember things that I think you have to remember too. While I recognize in the public conscience this may be an absolutely huge file in government, there would be hundreds of files that I would be working on or taking a glance at or trying to get off the ground in any given week. You've got HR issues, you've got all kinds of things coming at you as a deputy minister. So I think what we have is records that reflect the size and scope of projects. So if people think there are more, there are probably far more records on Hamburg or PMP because they were bigger files, much bigger files. But so I don't recall, if anything, it would be anything that I would have sent would have been out of the necessity of trying to work from home. So it could be anything, but wouldn't be common every day. It'd just be if there would be a glitch in the system on a particular day. But those records are sent to people. They're part of the ongoing legal court action. So they're not there. They are there.
Corey Deagle?
Did you take a records information management course when you first entered government?
I don't recall one.
No.
Corey?
I believe there was one. I think it came out in 2007. And it's under my understanding that all new employees would take that course. I'm just curious, did they want you to use your personal email account for?
Going back 13 years, I don't recall at all. I don't recall that, so I'd be guessing.
Corey?
How many files would you have used your personal email account with when doing government business?
It certainly wasn't common practice. So, again, if there was a night where you were trying to get something done or traveling, actually, many of us had issues traveling. There was lots of issues between BlackBerry and when you're trying to work off it that we couldn't connect to the system. That was quite frequent for a period of time. So it would really depend. And it wouldn't necessarily be this particular file. It could be any file just when you were trying to get a message out.
Corey?
So when you use your personal email account, anyone inside government, it doesn't fall under the FOIP. I can't FOIP your emails on those, correct? So I guess was there a concentrated effort within government to say any senior government official is working on the e-gaming file to use your personal email accounts to avoid being...
Absolutely not.
FOIP process.
Absolutely not. No, and even that, just recognizing it's like, oh yes, you know what? There will be times when you're frustrated and have to go to your own personal email. But that's not a concerted effort. That's a frustrated Thursday night.
Corey?
I guess I don't know if I quite buy the fact that we were using our personal email account to conduct government business on such an important file. And it was just simply, but you can remember that it was probably because you couldn't get into your group wise, but you can't remember really anything else when it comes around.
Well, I guess I would beg to differ on a couple of things. One is, it's at that point in time, as I explained, the loyalty card was a feasibility study. To say that it was the most important file in tourism is an overstatement by quite a bit. There were a lot of files, a lot. So this is called incubation. So, you know, I've seen my records. The majority of my records are from my email, government email account across the board. So to find one or two that are outside of that is, to me, would reflect the situation at the time.
Corey?
So you just said it was one of the biggest, I think what you said, it was one of the biggest programs inside, like loyalty card program?
Could be.
So you got to think, if you're going to ramp up an analytics program to the extent, it would take years to build. This was step, we have a CRM system, this would be a baby step to go, let's see if this is even possible. This wasn't full launch of a loyalty program. This was an assessment, feasibility assessment. We would do web development for operators. There's so many programs that this would be one of, again, a list of 25 on the go that might have potential, may pan out, they may not.
Corey?
Do you still have access to that personal email account? Would those records still be?
I would have to look, yep.
But does that email account still exist?
I can look.
Is Chair?
Corey, that's good.
Is that something you would be willing to do, is to provide the committee with relating to that, the loyalty card program?
For sure. I'll get back to you. I'll take a look.
Okay. Corey?
I don't know if anyone else has any.
Are there any other questions from other committee members? Corey, do you have your final questions? Are you finished?
So the 20s, sorry, Chair.
Okay.
The 2016,
take that as a yes, Corey.
The 2016 AG's report, the AG found you to be in a conflict of interest. I'm just wondering if you could expand on that, or if you have anything to say to that.
The Auditor General and your team had an enormous task, and I absolutely respect the work of the AG. I've worked with her in the past in government. I think having that oversight from an AG improves government every time. So that role is invaluable. Her work, obviously, you're here because of that work, and good things come out of that, and change comes out of that, and I think that's positive for everybody. And while I respect the role she had to play, I think reasonable, you know, minds can disagree on some of the outcomes, and it wouldn't just necessarily be in this particular audit. There are other audits where I didn't necessarily agree with findings. But you take those and you learn from those, and that's how I look at it.
Corey?
So you're saying you don't agree with the AG's findings?
I agree with the spirit and intent of what she found, and I certainly learned from it. But again, we can agree to disagree on some elements.
Corey?
So are you saying that you, to your belief, you were not in a conflict of interest, as the AG stated?
Like I said, there's some elements I don't agree with.
Corey?
What elements are those?
I think the report speaks for itself. And I've communicated that to her. And again, I respect her work, and I completely understand, and I've learned from that. So,
Corey?
And I guess this is important, because we don't have, your email account was deleted. And like rightfully so, there's a deletion order for it. A year after government, it was gone. But those records weren't retained for this important program. And now you're saying that you don't believe the AG's findings, that you were in a conflict of interest.
Findings. I certainly support her work.
You support the work, but
I think there was a lot of valuable things, regardless of whether I agree with everything or not. There was a lot to be learned.
So I guess, my question is what do you disagree with?
There'd be a lot of nuances, interpretations off the top of my head. Nothing that would be worth arguing over. But I can take the learning from it. I totally understand where she was coming from. And again, you know, living in a place like PEI and managing files where you know people is not unusual. And to deal with that, I think there's a lot of learnings, not just for myself, but for other leaders in government.
Corey?
So again, my question is what did you disagree with the Auditor General?
Nothing in particular, other than just that it's a challenging position as a deputy minister. And sometimes I think we probably need to spend some time on that as government, understanding governance in small jurisdictions.
Corey?
But you did say that you would have to agree to disagree with the AG on. So obviously you disagree on
governance in a small jurisdiction.
Okay, and what are those challenges?
I think you see it in a number of places, First Nations, small communities. You would see it as MLAs, you know, people on the street asking you, saying, hey, could you help me? I need to get a job. I need to get this. You get pulled in a lot of directions. And the one thing about PEI is, which makes it such a great democracy, is that everyone has access. But everyone has access. So when you're in a leadership role, everyone has access. People can see you on the street, they see you at the barbershop, they see you at Sobeys, and they're asking for things, right? They want to talk about something in their community, something at their workplace. So I think that challenge as a senior government official, that pressure is on everyone. So I think that's where the AG report, I think, is valuable when you have a lot of... people have a lot of access. I think there's a lot to be learned about how we could do better in terms of governing with those with that level of access.
Corey?
So I agree. We're a very small place. Everyone has access, but there are still rules that have to be followed. And I guess, why did the AG find you to be in a conflict?
I think the AG needs to answer that. I didn't find it. She did. She could answer that.
So you're not aware of why?
Not to the level of detail. No, I'm not.
Okay, I think that's enough for now. Yeah.
Are there any other questions at this time from committee members? Okay, on that basis, Melissa, I'd like to thank you for taking the time not only to do the presentation but to answer the questions from committee.
Okay.
If we'll conclude, take a brief recess so that you have the opportunity to finish up.
Okay.
If there's anything further you wanted to share with the committee before we close?
No, it's great. Thank you for the opportunity, and thank you, Ryan, for making this possible.
Thank you. So what we'll do, committee, is we'll just take a short recess so that the witness can leave the floor, and then maybe perhaps we'll use our remaining time before our next witness comes in to do the correspondence. But we'll just take a recess at this point. Okay. Our next witness is coming in for 11 o'clock, so we have the opportunity, if it is okay with the committee, to move to item number 4 on our agenda, which is the review of correspondence. Are there any objections? No? Okay, thank you. So, correspondence, there are two pieces here for the committee's consideration. The first is the letter from the Honourable Darlene Compton, Minister of Finance, in response to the committee's request for a briefing on the February 2020 ransomware attack on government and electronic records and security, dated October 30th. Did the committee have the opportunity to have a look at the letter? The brief takeaway from the letter is that during the spring, the minister points out that during the spring session of the legislature, she was asked questions relating to this matter, and that on July 2nd, 2020, she read into the record her response and has attached the answer from that date. And appreciating government security practices could lead to opportunities for further attacks or impede the RCMP investigation, she has been advised it is best not to discuss the situation further. So effectively, she will not be coming forward as requested to the committee, and has supplied her previous response for the committee's consideration. There is, as mentioned, the Hansard note, and then there is also a short summary regarding the malware attack. Does the committee have any thoughts on this response? Is this acceptable to the committee, or do you want to discuss it further? Gord McNeely?
I think it's disappointing that she can't come in and talk about this, and the quick nature and the what we're trying to find out as a committee, I think that it would have been nice to get a briefing. I mean, on her on this, it was a significant attack on things, and I think there's some questions unanswered. But I respect her writing back to committee, and I don't know how this committee can push giving the wrap up timeframes right now. So I'd just like to kind of maybe voice my displeasure on that.
Thank you, Gordon. Ola Hammerland.
Oh, just a short comment. I don't know if it's procedurally possible, but could you have an in-camera meeting that would allay your concerns about opening it up to the public?
Thank you, Ola. That's a good point. Is that something that the committee would like to consider?
No.
Corey Deagle?
That would be fine with me. I'm not sure if Gord... like if that's something that would...
Yeah, we could respond back. I'd like to... maybe that would be good. I think this is something that, you know, I'd like to... like a follow-up on some of those issues. So if something could be taken to the minister, that'd be great.
So I don't want to paraphrase, but I'm hearing from committee members that you would like to respond to this correspondence as suggesting an in-camera briefing. Mm-hmm. To address the concerns around security that the minister has raised. Clerk, would that be, do you feel that would be something we could?
Request an in-camera?
Request an in-camera briefing for the committee?
Committee could certainly make that request.
Yeah. Okay, so we have a response from committee members would be, in terms of responding to this is thank you, but can we request an in-camera briefing as a matter of urgency as well, to the point of Gordon's point about the time frame. Mm-hmm. Do we require a motion for that, or is that, can that just be done as a response in discussion?
If you could seek a motion, but if you feel there's general agreement already, you could take it as...
Would it be the committee's will to do that request? Yeah, I would say yes. Okay, thank you. The second piece of correspondence is a information follow-up information from Juliana McEwen, as discussed during her meeting with the committee, submitted November 5th. A reminder that Juliana is a records retention and records management expert who presented to committee, and she's provided a written follow-up on sort of three key points. One is adequate resources for record management. The next is using traveling devices, and the third is around Microsoft 365 and records management capability. Again, without reading the entire correspondence into the record, there's some really strong and clear recommendations in here, particularly around the principles of for resources for record management. I would point to the principles on the first page in that first section, saying that government departments should have the resources that allow government records be retained in accordance with retention disposition guidelines, established and approved record schedules. Unscheduled records should be retained until an appropriate schedule has been approved. Principle two is that government departments should have the resources to ensure government records must be accessible to all authorized users who need to use them. This includes program area staff working with the records, management and other departmental staff who may need to use them over time, and staff involved in freedom of information or litigation searches. And finally, principle three, government departments should have the resources to implement and maintain office record-keeping systems organized in accordance with the province's records classification and retention schedules that have been created. Those are really clear guidelines, principles, and they also pop up again when she mentions around traveling devices and in terms of the Office 365, that it's not a quick and easy solution and that you actually have to plan and have processes in place. So hopefully this additional information will be something that this committee can consider when it's preparing its report, because there's some really good, clear recommendations in there. And we thank Ms. McEwen for the time that she took to not only be a witness at the committee, but also to provide this, you know, this great follow-up information. Are there any comments or discussion from committee members on this? No? And that will be available on... Is this a question for Ryan? Is this available for people in terms of the public record, the correspondence?
It's part of the committee file, which is publicly accessible on request.
Okay, great. Okay. Does anybody have any other comments on the correspondence? No? Quiet committee. I'm not that scary. If we can move to motion, so item number five, is there any new business to be brought forward for the committee at this time? No? I will, yes.
I know it's not new business, but an update on what the scheduling is?
I will ask the clerk if he can provide us with that update.
After this morning's meeting, we have a meeting at 1:30 this afternoon, where Aaron McGrath Godet from the Deputy Minister of Economic Growth, Tourism and Culture will appear before the committee. That's the final scheduled meeting for the moment. I would assume we'll need to have at least a meeting, possibly more meetings to consider the committee's report, but those aren't scheduled as of yet. The committee had also made a request to the Treasury Board Secretariat of Canada for a briefing on federal government records management, but I haven't gotten a reply from that office yet.
Hal Perry?
Thank you. So the conversation during correspondence where the in-camera meeting request sent was that would be sent to the Minister of Finance, is that something that's going to happen prior to our committee making a report to the House? Or is that something that it would have to be? So that would have to be another scheduled meeting.
That's correct. Yeah, that would be correct. If you want to consider her response as part of your final report, then yes, that meeting, that briefing, though it could be obviously quite short, it could also be done, you know, online. But basically, that would need to take place for to be included in the consideration of your final report.
Can I question that again? I was just thinking about it, and I was wondering why. What's the purpose of it being in camera?
Because the reason for turning down coming to the committee is that she has stated that that she has been advised that there is a risk because of discussing government security practices that may then open up government for further attacks. So going into the detail of the potential vulnerability is in itself a vulnerability.
Okay, Chair. So the outcome of it, would we be able to make a recommendation from an in-camera meeting? Would we be able to, as a committee, make a recommendation to the House on an outcome from an in-camera?
Not necessarily, but not every briefing you have results in a recommendation. Mm-hmm. The point generally for the briefings is for the committee to be fully informed, so that it has a full picture of the information that it needs to be able to make recommendations across the to the original mandate of the committee. It really is about the committee's will on having, again, I wasn't obviously in this committee at that discussion, but it's quite clear that the committee made recognize that that particular aspect of records retention was something that they felt important enough to have on the agenda and had requested the minister to respond. We've heard today from committee members that they don't feel that this is adequate to come back to what has already been read into Hansard. And so it is about the big committee being informed as much as it needs to be, though it may not result in a direct recommendation.
Okay, Chair. My only concern is that there, we were told during this committee that there was no money put out to the ransom people, or whoever it was, right? But there was probably, I'm assuming, a considerable amount of taxpayers' dollars put out to find out, you know, what was going on, to try to deal with this ransomware issue that we had. So I'm just wondering, or not wondering, but I guess concerned that we're having an in-camera meeting talking about taxpayers' dollars and the security of government records, what the optics may look like for that part.
Yeah, absolutely.
I mean, we don't have to go into questions about, you know, detailed questions about the security part of and what we're doing, but maybe some concerns about the dollar amount that was spent.
I would point out, though, Mr. Perry, that the context of this request isn't about the expenditure. Mm-hmm. It's about the process of records retention and whether that was, from what I understand, whether that the process of records retention was at risk, because that the overall mandate of this committee is about ensuring that records that are used for decision making, that are government records, are being retained and can be accessed appropriately. The risk from in this context, the discussion is about, were those records in some way damaged? So, for instance, have there been records that we've lost, or are they deleted? Could be part of the context. So it's not about expenditures as much as it is about process, perhaps. But the other side of this is again, that the minister herself has indicated that she will not come to the committee if it is a discussion that's going to be happening in public. So the requirement for it to be in camera is a response to the parameters that the minister has herself placed in terms of appearing. That would, so that the optics of that would be the responsibility of the person that made that requirement, perhaps.
Okay, Chair. Thank you for that, and I do appreciate that. I just again go back to, I do believe it has an important part of our mandate of the committee, because moving forward, we need to learn from the past. So if there was a breach in our record management, we need to know what we can do moving forward to prevent that and to prevent the possibility of taxpayers putting in a lot of money.
What I would suggest to the committee in that case is that we should have a formal motion on this so that we can make a decision that's clear. The conversation, if we go back to this, Clerk, if this is okay, I'm just sort of checking with you after the fact there, but just for clarity, the correspondence effectively says that the minister is turning down the invitation from the committee. Gordon McNeely expressed his disappointment in that. And there was a suggestion that this could perhaps be done as in-camera instead to address the specific concern or reason that was given for turning down the invitation. Gordon, would you like to make a motion to that effect?
Yeah, I think that we could make a motion to resend a letter and potentially get the minister to appear. She's welcome to legal counsel on that. She's welcome to answer any questions that she wants or doesn't want to, but I do believe to do this work that we need to see her and to figure out what happened with this. So I would make a motion to I would just be the first one we sent was, I mean, what, I'm not sure about the, can I get a recess for a second? Will I
just, yeah. Yeah. We'll just recess for a moment to confer with the clerk. Okay, we're back online. I just had a little kind of discussion on some of the details on how to word the motion. Perhaps, Gord, if you'd like to return.
I would like to make a motion that we thank the minister for correspondence, but feel very strongly this committee wants her to appear in a very timely manner about this important issue, and it should be done in front of the public domain.
Corey Deagle?
I'm not against having the minister in.
Mm-hmm.
I think she stated some good points in her letter.
Mm-hmm.
In our public accounts meeting when, I think, Ryan, are you clerk public? Yeah. When IT was in, part of that meeting we moved in camera. Am I correct?
I think you're referring to the meeting with the Auditor General to review the IT security access audit.
Yes, that's right. Because there was
partially in camera.
And it was just there's nothing, I don't think anyone's trying to hide anything. Mm. It's just, but I understand what you're doing. You don't want it to be in camera. Maybe, can we ask them, the minister or the department what they can discuss publicly? Mm. And perhaps there can be a component of the meeting where we hold it publicly, and then if there's some sensitive material that they genuinely don't want out there because of risk to Islanders, it's not politics.
Yeah.
You'd have the option to go in
to
camera.
To go in camera during the meeting. It's a suggestion. I'm not trying to play defense here.
Would that be acceptable, Gord?
I think there is a realistic ask of what.
Yeah, I'm okay with that as well.
So clerk, we'd be able to sort of to provide that option in the correspondence that should there be, and that would address the concerns that the minister has raised and the concerns that the committee members have raised. Okay. So if we're okay with that approach as a motion, may I have any further discussion? We're okay with that? Then can I just ask for a vote from the voting members on the motion as presented? All those in favour?
Aye.
Okay. So motion is carried in that. Thank you for that discussion. That was good. We got there. and that has used our time. So that worked out quite well. I think we just need to take a short recess again to bring our next witness in. And then we'll be proceeding with the final part of the meeting. Thank you. Welcome back to the Special Committee on Government Records Retention. So we're returning back to, on our agenda, back to item number three. And would like to welcome Chris LeClair, who is here to present to the Special Committee on Government Records Retention. Chris, do you have a presentation for
yes.
us? I'm
yeah,
seeing
just a short, okay. short presentation.
So what we'll do is go through your presentation, and then we'll go to questions
Perfect.
From the committee afterwards.
Yeah.
Great. Just a reminder that the microphone isn't an amplification microphone.
Okay.
It's just a picking up for the record.
Okay.
So we need you to project.
Yeah.
And when we're doing questions, I'll just kind of pause and introduce, acknowledge members so that we can
okay.
have time to do the transition.
Yeah.
Great.
Okay, thank you.
Have the floor.
Okay, just as background, I served as chief of staff to Robert Giz in that capacity from June 2007 to October 2011. So for the last 9 years, I've been self-employed with my own consulting company. So I know you've been asked by the House to study records in a privacy commissioner order issued in 2020. I think it's useful for you to know that I was not involved in that proceeding in any capacity. You're also asked by the House, as my understanding is, to study the current practices in relation to the retention of electronic records of government. Now, my knowledge would be limited to my time in government, which ended in 2011, and so I'm not up to speed on what the current practices might be. Like everyone else, I read the newspaper, but I'm not sure what the current sort of issues are at play, so I would just ask your indulgence when in that fact when raising questions with me. The committee has invited me here, is my understanding, to discuss the findings of the Auditor General regarding the retention of records. And so I did meet with the Auditor General back at the time when the report was prepared. We discussed sort of in very general terms records management to the extent that of my involvement, and did my best to be cooperative. All of my emails and paper files were left with government in 2011, and so the best point of reference in terms of understanding my documents, I suppose, would be IT Shared Services. According to the Auditor General, my understanding is the normal practice to remove email accounts when a person left government was the process that would have been followed with respect to my files and emails. All my emails were left at government in 2011. I did use government emails, and I've seen government emails to defend myself in the litigation that of which we're all aware. I look forward to the invitation here to talk about my records. I hope this information is helpful. But my knowledge and capacity in terms of shedding light on the issues before you are pretty limited to the period prior to 2011. So I'll leave it at that.
Thank you, Mr. LeClair, sorry. I have questions from committee members on the floor. Corey Deagle.
Thank you, Chair, and thank you, Chris. When you first came into government as the Chief of Staff to the Premier, did you take any records information management courses, records retention, was that?
When I first came into government?
Yeah.
There would have been some maybe very general comments or direction, but I wouldn't call it any courses or anything of that significance.
Corey Deagle?
Did you ever keep paper copies of emails or records, or
because
it just simply wasn't? I leave government, my emails are all deleted. Like there are important files in those emails.
Sure, no, I mean there were files I would have left in government, but in terms of making significant records of emails, I wouldn't have done that.
Corey Deagle?
Did you have any knowledge, I guess, before you left government, that your emails would be deleted after you left?
I had really no knowledge of what would happen as a result of leaving government with respect to records management in terms of what would happen. I've since learned that there's processes that are followed in terms of what happens when emails or accounts are disabled, and then I understand they're kept for a period of time, and then after a designated period of time, they're removed. But no.
Corey?
Did any time, either before you left government or after, request that your emails be deleted?
Rick's.
Did you ever request that your emails be deleted?
No.
Corey?
Was it, when you left government, did you say, there's important emails in my account that should be archived, they shouldn't be deleted? Did that ever?
No, I mean, when I left government, I left with my, you know, with my computer sort of intact, and I just assumed that whatever process was followed would be the normal course of events, right?
Corey?
I'm wondering if, so when you left, it was the then Premier Robert Giz that signed the deletion form, which is proper in government, that happens, and it's record public knowledge. So you're saying you had no, that it was Mr. Giz that, that ordered the deletion of your records, that you had nothing to do with, because it's very, you know, everyone's emails that we can't find for that period of time related to the e-gaming file. Now yourself, Ms. James, Mr. Mix, those emails are all missing. Do you find that kind of?
What I know from a recent Supreme Court decision is that over the same period, 1,054 people's emails were handled in the precisely the same manner that I assume my emails were handled. And so a suggestion that, I don't understand the suggestion that something untoward happened when everything I read from the court's findings suggests that what happened to me, my records, happened to 1,000 other people.
Corey?
However, so Mr. Mix's emails were, we can't find those emails for that exact period of time related to.
I know nothing about Mr. Mix's emails. I wouldn't have been around or involved in that.
He's been in the news quite often, and he was a player in the e-gaming file, which you were the chief of staff to the premier at the time, so most certainly you must have an idea of what.
So when did, I don't, you know, give me the time frame that Mr. Mix's emails went missing.
It was 2010 to, I think it was around 2012. There's a month in each of those years that it.
I mean, what I know is I left government. I didn't even think of whatever records management or processes were followed. I left. We fast forward to the period we're at now, and there is suggestions that emails were intentionally deleted. All I can say to you is I didn't delete any emails. I can only comment on what I read. I would urge the committee to perhaps take the opportunity to get a briefing on the recent Supreme Court decision, which said sort of unequivocally that documents were not, emails were not intentionally deleted. I mean, they use a term in legal terms, and I'm not a lawyer. It's called spoliation, and the court ruled very, very forcefully that, in their view, documents weren't deleted. Emails weren't removed, and they strike those allegations from the recent lawsuit in which there was a ruling last week. So I don't know how to respond beyond the fact that my own emails were there when I left government. My understanding is that what happened to them is the normal course of action, a course of action that was accompanied by another 1,000 people. In the same vein from the way these things are managed. And I don't really have much more insight because I'm now not in that chair, so.
Corey?
Would you find, I guess, is it not concerning that after you left government in 2011, so you're the chief of staff to the premier, and obviously would have stick-handled a number of major files, including I'm assuming most likely the e-gaming file, that no one figured it might be important that your email account would hold very important information and that we should keep those records archived. Because I know of employees that have left government that their emails they can still access years after, because there's really never unless someone puts in the delete, like the form for it to be deleted, removed, it doesn't happen. So I guess you were the chief of staff to the premier, and it was just, okay, he's been gone, let's get rid of his email account and all those emails in it. But now you did say that you do have access to some of those that you used in your defense.
Through the course of litigation, I've seen them surface in terms of requests. But look, again, I come back to the point where, you know, my understanding was that when people leave government, there is a process. That process defines how email accounts are removed. It's tied to the limited availability of email addresses and that sort of information. You know what, I say again, like the courts, when they looked at this, took a very deep dive into this issue, and the findings of both the trial court and the appeal court was that nothing untoward happened with the email records of myself and other people in government that has been alleged. And I know this is a very serious concern for the committee, and it's an important topic for them to address. But that's the only way I can respond at this point 9 years later, is what I know to be in the public record in terms of a finding of a court decision.
Corey Deagle?
Those emails, you said that some that have surfaced from your email account, I'm assuming that they're all probably in the public sphere, that in court.
Yeah, I would think they would be contained in affidavits and referenced in some manner.
Corey?
Have you ever used a personal email account to conduct government business when you were... No.
Corey?
Was it ever a direction to use government or personal email accounts?
A direction from whom?
I guess from yourself, from the when dealing with the e-gaming file, because we just had Miss James in. We did use her personal email account to conduct government business on this file. And what was a big initiative at the time.
Yeah.
And clearly, if you use your personal email account, you avoid the FOIP. You can't be FOIPed, right? So.
I'm probably the most FOIPed person in Prince Edward Island, and there are hundreds and if not thousands of pages of my documents floating around. So if I was to have done some kind of good job at masking that, I wouldn't have a stack of files in my office called FOIP.
Corey Deagle?
And I appreciate that. So you said that you never took a records management course, or?
No, I didn't take a records management course.
Chair.
Corey?
So as one of the top staff in the government, as the chief of staff to the premier, you never took a records management course?
There was a FOIP presentation that I recall being made, that would have been made probably to myself and a bunch of folks, if I recall, but I'd ask you to realize that we're now back in 2007, so we're 13 years ago, and I do remember some measure of information being provided, but it wasn't an individual course where I sat down by myself with an instructor, but there may have been some information provided. I recall something of that sort.
Corey?
And it never came up that perhaps some of your files should be archived and kept and not deleted?
Look, it may have came up, but I was a pretty busy person, and quite frankly, didn't keep a lot of files. When you're in the Premier's office, you're brought into provide input and direction on a whole series of initiatives across government. And so as a result, a lot of the information doesn't reside with you, if you understand what I mean. Like, it resides in other line departments where you're brought in to provide advice and input. So that's, you know, the nature of what a chief of staff does is drops into a meeting, provides some input and guidance, and then kind of goes elsewhere to something, to the next issue.
Corey?
So you never made a kind of concentrated effort to make sure that some of those files and records were archived? Thanks, Chair. Did you ever use BBM messages to...
BlackBerry?
Like, yes, yes.
I had a BlackBerry.
And used it, yeah.
Corey?
Did you ever archive any of those messages?
I never archived, wouldn't even begin to know how to archive a BlackBerry message.
That's okay,
even
Corey.
When making decisions for government on those messages?
Which is a record of government.
BlackBerries are a form of communication. I wouldn't have made a lot of decisions over BlackBerries. I would have been asked for information or feedback, that sort of thing. But no, I didn't know about archiving BlackBerry messages, nor did I.
So, on the e-gaming file, the AG's report, I guess, speaking to that, would you have used the BlackBerry BBM for any communication on that file?
I may have. I don't know for certain. If through the course of business, I may have.
Do you have someone else that wants to jump in?
Not right now.
No.
No. Okay. About 5 more minutes. Ish.
Okay. So during your time as Chief of Staff, can you just give the committee a kind of a broad context of what your involvement was in e-gaming and the financial services platform?
As related to the AG's report, I guess.
Sure. So as related to the AG's report, my understanding is I am here to respond to the AG's report insofar as it relates to records management. And so we've had a discussion about records management. So are there some specific questions about records management in relation to the AG's report, which is what my understanding was as to why I'm here? I'm happy to answer those questions.
I don't know. Can you answer my question that I just asked?
Well, you're asking me about the e-gaming report generally. What I'm suggesting is my understanding was I'm here to respond to questions about the records management component of the Auditor General report.
Okay. So perhaps
I apologize if I'm not getting the question.
Well, the question was quite simple, and my first number of questions were on records management and archiving records, which you claim to have no knowledge of archiving records, even though being the Chief of Staff to the Premier for a number of years, the highest position, one of the highest positions in government. It's probably concerning that the Chief of Staff to the Premier wasn't really sure how to archive records, and then to expect all of government to follow the proper processes beneath you. So I guess, again, I'm just wondering if you can give the committee context of your involvement in the e-gaming file and the financial services platform at the time.
It was one of, I mean, the e-gaming file would have been one of, you know, I don't know the number, 50 ongoing files that the Premier's office would be involved with, not from a directional perspective, but from an input and kind of oversight perspective.
Corey?
I guess that's, I understand that. There would be a number of files going on at any given time. Would you have been one of the lead persons in this file?
I wouldn't say I would have been one of the lead persons. I was a person. The fact is, when you're the Chief of Staff, by definition of your position, that puts you in, you know, a leadership position. But it was one of 50 files on an ongoing basis that would have taken up my time.
Corey?
So I guess, again, I'm wondering if you can give the committee context in your involvement with that file.
I'm not sure what you're asking me when you're saying you'd like my context.
A general context of what your involvement was.
I would have, you know what, I would have attended meetings. I would have been asked for my opinion. I would have, you know, been involved in that file in the manner that I would have been involved in a number of files.
Corey?
So this is, it was a big file. And in the fall of 2009, you traveled with Wes Sheridan to the Isle of Man. Do you recall that?
Yes, yeah.
And what was the purpose of that trip?
That trip was to investigate the model of e-gaming.
All right.
And so Mr. Sheridan had expenses for that trip, which are publicly known. The AG was not able to find any record of your expenses. I'm just curious as to why.
I do not know that. But I'm going to return to the fact that I'm here to discuss records management, and I come here as a volunteer before the committee to discuss records management. And my understanding was that I'm here to discuss questions in relation to the records management section of the AG report, which is the mandate of this committee, as I understand. So, you know, if you want to ask me questions pertaining to that, I participated in the Auditor General's report. I volunteered when I was asked and then appeared before the Auditor General and responded to all her questions. I'm not prepared here to reconduct the AG report and the floor of the legislature in a manner that diverts this committee from what its mandate is. So if you have some questions pertaining to the mandate of this committee, I'm happy to respond.
Thank you, Chair.
Corey?
I appreciate that, Mr. LeClair. And I guess my question evolves around the AG's report and the fact that you couldn't provide any records of your expenses for that trip. So that's why I'm asking about records. Do you have any idea how you got to the Isle of Man? Certainly someone must have paid for it.
I know how I got to the... I traveled there. I'm not aware of what the issue is with the records, but I'm certainly aware that I went there.
Corey?
Well, I guess the issue is that there is none. So who paid for it?
You'd have to ask the people responsible for the records.
Which would be you? Which is why I'm asking.
I would have returned and from the Isle of Man and provided all my receipts and documents. I wouldn't have paid for them myself. But as I say, I'm not aware of how the expenses would have been filed in relation to that.
Corey?
But you are responsible. You must know how you got there and who paid for it.
You know, of course I know. I traveled there, and I traveled there, and I went there. There would have been expenses incurred, no question. But, again, I come back to the fact that, that pertains to the management of e-gaming. If there are specific questions here about records management in relation to lost records, I'm happy to do the best that I can do in terms of providing the committee with some advice.
Thank you, and I am trying to figure out, I guess, how the records were lost, of how you somehow ended up on the Isle of Man and are not sure who paid for it or how you got there.
I traveled to the Isle of Man as part of my duties and would have assumed that those expenses were part of the overall file or project expense associated with that.
Do you know why the AG wasn't able to obtain those expenses?
I don't know what situation the Auditor General faced in that regard.
So did government pay for that trip, or was it?
I would assume so.
So if government paid for it, there should be copies of those expenses?
I would assume so.
Okay, so for the record, it was government that paid for that trip?
I would have assumed it would have been government that paid. I didn't pay for it personally, Mr. Deagle.
Okay, Corey?
Yeah, you can jump to Hal.
Okay. Hal Perry?
Oh, thank you very much, Chair, and thank you for coming in today, Mr. LeClair. For myself, I'm not a lawyer, so I'll depend on the judgment of institutions. And in the recent court case, the Supreme Court of PEI was very clear that any cancellation of email accounts was done, and I'll quote them, in accordance with the applicable protocol and ordinary course of business. So as a committee, I think we've heard that these protocols and practices have improved since the amendments made to the Act, and we may have other recommendations to make in a report, which is a good thing. And I'm not sure what practical advice you can give us on records management and retention. With all due respect, you're clearly not an expert on either matter. But, however, I should say, would you have any recommendations to this committee that we could maybe use in a report to the legislature this fall?
You're correct. I'm not an expert. I mean, I would encourage the committee to ask for and receive a briefing on the recent Supreme Court ruling, because that ruling dealt with, in a very specific way, issues surrounding emails and email management in government, and it examined the issue and allegations that have been out there in the public domain and before the courts regarding intentional intentional elimination of emails. And the court was quite emphatic about the fact that you know, emails were not deleted in relation to this file. You know, they raised the point repeatedly about emails. And if I can, there's a point at which the decision reads, and I quote here, "The evidence shows that the policy and procedure the province has had in place since at least 2007 was that once a person left the employment of the government, ITSS, Information Technology Shared Services, first disabled the email account of the former employee, then removed the email account, but kept a backup of the email account for a period of 365 days. And after that, they are no longer available. They did so because of the costs and types of licenses. Between the years 2007 and 2011, they followed this procedure 1,054 times for employees, ranging from secretaries right through to the Premier's office." So, quite clearly, the process that happened around my departure is the process that is the normal course of process. And so, as such, I think understanding and learning from the decision of the committee and the thousands of pages of evidence presented would be time well spent by this committee, because it represents a comprehensive examination of this issue, precisely the same issue that the committee has sort of set for itself as one of its key areas of inquiry.
Hal Perry.
And that's fine. Thank you very much for that. And I appreciate you coming in today. You know, I really feel bad for a number of people who have had their names basically dragged through the mud for the last several years with some acquisitions, and you know, everyone's been acquitted of that. It can do damage not only to the individual but also to society with some of these conspiracy theories that are floating around. So I do appreciate that you did take our invitation to come in here today and to answer our questions and give us some recommendations that will help us in the future. So, again, thank you.
Okay. Corey?
Thank you, Chair. And, you know, we probably could have all done this 3 years ago until the Liberals at the time reversed the motion to call the witnesses into committee. So it's a little ironic hearing that from the member. Mr. LeClair, I guess, did you take any steps after you realized that your email account was incomplete to try and rectify that? Or, like, were you concerned when it came out in reports that your emails were inaccessible through FOIP?
So when would it have come out in reports?
Oh, the AG's report?
So I leave government in 2011, and in 2000, was the AG report 2016?
Yeah.
So you're asking me what you're asking me if I did something at that point?
I'm curious that once that came out, were you, you know, my gosh, I can't believe that all those records are gone. I'm going to try and help them.
But let's be clear. The records are gone in relation to a procedure that was followed 1,054 times. And so I'm not certain as to what you're asking of me.
I guess, were you concerned when you're, yes, there's EMIT records gone, but records are also supposed to be archived, which are government decisions.
The Auditor General, the Court of Appeal has said what I've read about the findings in terms of the email. And it said that the evidence is that LeClair left the employ of the province in October 2011. His email account was removed on November 2nd, and a backup held for 365 days. McCachran's email was removed October 21st. Beck's email was removed October 10th, 2012, and backed up 365 days. All of these accounts were removed following the standard policy and procedure that the province had for all employees for many years. They were all removed well before December 30th, 2014, when the appellant served notice of their intention for a course in action. What happened with my emails is the normal course of action that happens with emails. And the fact that 5 or 6 years later, these questions are being raised, you know, at the time, I'm a private citizen, Mr. Deagle. I'm not an agent of government anymore. I haven't been an agent of government for almost a decade. So, you know, I have a routine process of FOIP requests for all of my emails that come across my desk. You know, every 3 or 4 months, and I do my best to respond to those. But that's the extent to which I kind of deal with sort of records of government.
So everyone seems well-versed on the facts and the stats of how we get rid of emails and records, but no idea of how that we're supposed to archive certain records. So you never archived any records from your email account as while chief of staff?
I don't believe I archived records, no.
Corey?
Okay, so any decisions that were made were not archived?
My understanding of, my limited understanding of what that arc process would be is, you know, I would handle many files in government. I would have paper files, I would have electronic files, but as a result of my time in government, I managed those files, but I did not keep kind of detailed, extended records and documents. There would have been a filing system, I'm sure, that I would have given information to. All of that would have been left with government when I left, as a matter of course. That's all I can tell you.
Are there any other questions from committee at this time? Mr. LeClair, I'd like to thank you on behalf of the committee for, as a citizen, coming in to committee and answering the questions, providing the information as requested. What we'll do at this point is, if there's no further questions, we'll take a short recess to allow you time to finish up. We do need a copy of your presentation for our...
It's been sent.
Okay, great. That was going to be my last thing. So just take a very short recess. Then we're just going to come in. We just have one or two other small pieces of business to finish before we adjourn. So if you can stay in your seats, please. I'll be short. Okay, so committee, that is the end of the presentations for today, and we've already done the review of correspondence. I just need to do a couple of quick housekeeping things that the clerk has brought to my attention. We had a conversation with our first witness, Melissa James, at which time committee member Corey Deagle asked if she would be able to provide her own personal records regarding the loyalty card program, and we need to make it clear that is a request from the committee to do so. It can't come as a personal request from the committee member, but that is that. So I would need to just have agreement from the committee that we are making a motion to request that those records from her personal records regarding the loyalty records program be provided to the committee. Hal Perry?
Can I ask for what purpose?
Corey?
Well, those are records of government that should be in the hands of government, not a personal email account.
Hal Perry?
So what are we going to do with any personal records or any government records? And how does that fit into our mandate?
That's up to the committee. It was a request made by a committee member to a witness. The witness agreed. The request needs to come from the committee. And so I'm asking the committee to confirm that that is a request of this committee so that we can make that formal request on its behalf.
I don't know what would be the proper wording for...
Motion that the committee seek the personal records as from Melissa James as...
That the committee asks Melissa James, Ms. James, for the government records in her personal email account that she agreed that she would look for and provide if she had those records.
How?
I have no problem with that. And she absolutely said yes. You know what I mean? She had nothing to hide, so she would do it. I'm just questioning the purpose of those emails and what we are going to do with them and how that is going to help us with our mandate.
That's up for the committee to decide. Yeah. There is obviously, you know, an aspect of this is the committee study, the missing records referred to in the order and the current practices related. So there is an aspect of studying those records and whatever is available and using those to make a recommendation.
So
what I would ask for is that the committee vote on the motion that's on the floor.
Okay. Chair, so are you or is it the assumption that those emails are the missing emails?
I'm not in a position to make that comment. The request has been that the committee is seeking to see those. That is the extent of the motion.
Okay.
I'm not here to comment on the content.
Again, I have no problem with that. She did agree to do it, and I have no problem with that. It's just we have a workload, a huge workload, and I don't know if this is going to put us back or not. But I mean, I'll go with the pleasure of the committee. So.
Perhaps if I can ask for, we have a motion on the floor from Corey Deagle to seek the committee seek those records as requested. Can I have a vote from the committee members on that motion? All in favour, indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Okay, so I have two votes for and two abstentions. Okay. And we are short a committee member today, so chair, sorry, clerk, I have a 2-2.
Are the...
I'm a no.
Okay, so those are no. Then the chair would have to vote to break the tie.
Okay, so I'm going to vote in favour of the motion on the floor. Okay, thank you very much, committee, for assisting with closing off that business. I think at this stage, I'm just going to check again that there's no other new business from committee at this time. No? On that basis, then, can I have a motion to adjourn, please? So move, Corey Deagle. We are adjourned. Thank you.